Okay, so let's get started. So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Holstein Canada webinar series. I am Murilo Carvalho, one of education and extension specialists here at Holstein Canada, along with Ben Charlton and Melissa Marcoux. Some of you may be familiar with me. I used to be a classifier. Now I'm in the office. So just a few housekeeping things before we get started. So we are recording this webinar, so you can have access to it later, but don't leave, stay on, it's going to be good. Also, we will ask everyone to keep their microphones muted while we are presenting. Anyone that has a question can either ask in the end, we're going to give the floor, or write in the chat box anytime during the presentation. So the chat box is in the bottom of the video. You just click on chat. And it's going to pop the chat box and you can write your question there. So we're going to try to address all the questions while still in the meeting. If you're not able to, if you don't have time, we're going to at least give some feedback later. So finally, we're going to have a couple of polls during the presentation. So keep an eye to answer them as we discuss here. So first, I would like to introduce our speakers for today. We have the pleasure to bring two great industry members, Dr. Christine Baes and Chris McLaren. So Dr. Christine Baes was born and raised on a dairy farm in southwestern Ontario and learned to appreciate Canadian agriculture at a young age. After completing her bachelor's degree at Guelph, she completed her master's and PhD in livestock genetics in Germany. She then became a professor in Guelph and has delivered presentations and courses around the world. Besides her contribution to different Holstein Canada committees and the Genetic Evaluation Board, she's involved in various livestock breeding projects, as she is the Canada Research Chair in Livestock Genomics. Together with her team, she strives to bridge the gap between cutting-edge research and practical application of new knowledge. Even though she's a very busy person, she finds some spare time to run a small cash crop farm just outside of Maryhill. Thank you so much, Dr. Baes, for accepting our invitation to be here today. Along with Dr. Baes, we have Chris McLaren from Larenwood Farms in Drumbo, Ontario. Along with his dad, Grant, and his uncle, Dan, Chris is the sixth generation farming. After getting a bachelor's and a master's degree from Guelph, Chris came back to the home farm where they milk around 110 cows with about 500 acres of cash crop land. Almost 9 years ago, they moved from a tie stall barn to a sand-bedded freestall barn. Since then, the focus has been paying attention to details and improving the operation day by day. And it is easy to tell that they have been doing a great job. Larenwood received the highest management score award from Canada SDHI 3 years in a row. And in 2020, they were awarded a Master Breeder Shield from Holstein Canada. The herd nowadays averages just over 13,000 kilos of each 3 or 5 days lactation, with about 30% of the cows on the herd having received superior production awards. Nowadays, about 50% of the herd is classified very good or higher. Welcome, Chris, and also thanks a lot for being here with us today. So, before we start, we're going to start with a poll in a little bit different way. So for you in the audience, we're going to bring up the poll so you can answer. And it's basically how long have you been genomic testing your females? Less than 2 years, 2 to 4 years, 4 more years, or you have never tested before. So we're going to wait another couple of seconds to get more results. Seeing good response. Right, so yeah, about 40% of the answers never tested before. Few that have been testing for a little while, so that's pretty good. So very diversified audience here. So let's start. Let's get rolling. Chris, first question for you: how long have you been using genomics, and how does genomics have influenced your breeding strategy? Can you give us a little bit of an overview of your breeding strategy, which traits are paying most attention?
Yeah, well, start off with thanks for inviting me to speak in the webinar series. I love to sit and talk about cows and talk about the barn and all that. So I'm more than happy to come. So I probably talked Merlo's ear off when we were first making sure the connection worked, but I really enjoy it. Genomically testing, we've been doing every animal for 3 years. We did have a spell where we tested, sporadically tested a few animals here or there, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, and just didn't to use the information. But I believe you got to test all the animals to get a real good handle on what's going on in the herd. As far as our breeding decisions, we use genomics as a culling decision, as well as we also use it to select the top 15% to breed to sex semen and the bottom 20% to breed to beef. And generally the bottom percent will be some of the older cows. It is tough to breed a good high producing older cow to beef. So what we've done with that group is we give them one chance with as good a genomic bull as I can find to try and catch them up a little. And if they don't conceive, they get bred to beef. I have a soft spot for some of my old cows. So that's kind of the compromise that I have, I've taken with myself. We also, generally the traits I look for mostly on index, we use LPI Pro Dollar pretty heavily, but I really dig deeper into the details on the proof sheets, looking for things like all the health traits being positive, fat yield, fat deviation being positive, 500 liters or more of milk as well. I'm finding as I breed for fat more and more, I need to look at some of the liters as well as just fat percent, because the yield isn't getting as high an improvement as I would like as we move forward. I look at, you know, center ligament, udder texture, moderate stature, capacity, feet and legs, and try to really, the goal mostly is to try and simply make the daughter better than the mother. And whatever that is, when you look at her components and what she's made up of through classification, and match it with the genomic bulls and genomic proofs. So that's what we do.
Awesome. Thank you so much. So now moving for Dr. Baes, can you point the importance of having both genotype and phenotypic information to help with the management of the herd?
Yeah. Also for me, thanks for inviting me to speak with you guys today. It's really exciting to have that the real communication face-to-face, well, as face-to-face as we can get during these strange times. So genotyping is a tool. It's not a magic bullet. And like any individual tool, it can't be used alone to get a job done. So in breeding, we think of a phenotype or a trait like milk production or size or fertility as being caused by both the genetics of an animal as well as the environment that that animal is in. So to explain where a phenotype or trait is coming from, you need to know about the trait itself as well as the genetics of the animal and the environment that that animal is in. So only when you have data on all three factors can you really use that information to predict how an animal will perform. Genotyping really helps us do two things. On the one hand, it helps get rid of, it helps us select animals earlier than conventional methods, because we have a reference population telling us which genes are affecting the important traits. And from a research perspective, it also helps us better understand the genetic architecture of those important traits. So it's overall a good tool, but we need to have both sides of the equation in order to make real progress.
Awesome. Thanks a lot. Chris, going back to you, you have been genotyping, but you mentioned we still classify. How do you match the two tools together to make better decisions?
Well, I definitely would reiterate what Dr. Baes was saying, is that you need to have, for me, I look at three things when I'm making decisions on culling. I look at the genotype information, the genomics of that animal. I look at her pedigree, and I look at the animal in front of me. And those are the three decisions I make. So I realize when I'm genotyping the animals that 73% accuracy is what I have. So sometimes there's animals that I know more about the pedigree, and I know more about the classification information that I've seen in that line of cows that perhaps there's something that I want to keep in that animal. As well as, so classification for me is a tool to really see whether I'm making progress in how I've been selecting and choosing bulls, not just to 100% rely on the genotypes or the genomics of the results that I get. So, and I also do realize that in order to keep accuracy in the system, there has to be known data, there has to be classification information, there has to be milk production information to keep and drive the accuracy up in what these genomic proofs produce. So I think that's how we mostly use it.
Going back to Christine, from the industry standpoint, how is genomics impacting the breed's genetic gains, and which traits are you seeing the most impact, the most improvement since genomics started?
Oh, that's a great question. Genomics improves accuracy of estimated breeding values. It allows us to select much earlier than before. And as many of you know, in the last decade, we've really seen just gargantuous increases in genetic gain. It's kind of like being on a train. We're on the same train that we were on before, but now we can go at a much faster rate. So to the first point, genomics can improve accuracy in all the traits, but it's really the traits with low heritability where genomics shows a particularly positive effect. Furthermore, traits that are expensive or really difficult to measure can also now be incorporated into our breeding strategy through the use of genomics, because we can collect those phenotypes on a smaller number of animals and then extrapolate the effects to the rest of the population. So traits like fertility and health, and now feed efficiency, they were really difficult to improve with conventional breeding, but genomics gives us an opportunity to make much larger gains in those areas. Now, to the second point regarding early selection, we're constantly improving our reference population thanks to producers like Chris. So all we need now really is a young animal's DNA to have a pretty good idea of what its performance will look like. If we maintain that reference population containing animals with really detailed phenotypes and genotypes, that means that we can, as soon as an animal is born, all we need is its DNA, and we can figure out what that animal, what its potential is. Of course, housing and nutrition and management also have to be in order so that animals can reach their full genetic potential. But it's really those two things that make our train go faster.
Awesome. I love that. The train idea. Sounds good. So we're going to just bring a slide up now. So Chris, take a look at Larenwood's genetic progression over the last decade. We can notice that both LPI and ProDollars are definitely increasing, especially I believe since you started genotyping more intensively. And actually, it seems that these selections paying off. Looking at this other graph, we see that actually the cows with higher LPI, they're producing more, they have higher BCA fat. So at the same time, if we look at some other graphs, we know that you have been selecting a little bit more for other traits such as health and fertility of the daughters, as we can see in these two graphs. So how are these, specifically these traits, more in the health and fertility, how are they impacting your herd performance? Have you observed some steady gain and seeing more longevity out of the cows?
Yes, I've been seeing some more longevity, and the specific traits there you showed on daughter fertility and fat production, the gains that we've made in the last 3 years since we've been genomically testing all of our animals have been quite surprising and very, very pleasing. Now we look at I was a little bit late logging on this morning because I had herd health this morning and things ran a little bit late, but that's where really you see the where daughter fertility is starting to impact the herd. We've had some fertility issues in our older cattle over the last year or so, but when you look at that graph that was just shown, we've been trying to work on the management, which there's some transitioning issues we need to improve. But also, when you look at the animals that are in their third lactation or greater, those are animals that are genetically set up to have poor fertility. And that is really good information. And now looking forward, I'm seeing better fertility in the two-year-olds. So the two-year-old conception rates are in the 50% range. Second lactation conception rates, or preg rates, sorry, not conception, preg rates, are in the 35 to 40% in second lactation, but the third lactation girls are in, you know, not poor, but relatively poor, are more in the 16 to 22 or 3% range. So genetically, they're set up not to be conceiving, and we've been making good gains in there, which is pleasing to see. And as well on pro dollar and LPI overall indexes, yeah, we're definitely making gains there as well. So,
awesome.
Yeah.
Great to hear that, and great to see that progression actually returning for you, right? It's nice to see that. So, Dr. Baes, we're seeing more and more herds focusing on functional traits such as health and fertility traits, but we know that they are not easy to improve. And why is that? Why is the reason that?
That's a great question too. Health and fertility are really, really complex. On the one hand, they're polygenic, meaning that they are influenced by many, many different genes spread across the genome. The bovine genome has about 3 billion letters in it, so it's a pretty difficult task to find out exactly which letters are affecting these traits. On the other hand, they're also what I call fuzzy traits, meaning that their definitions are pretty nebulous and they're not really clear cut. We've been quite pragmatic and a little bit cheap, really, about defining these traits in the past, but that's changing as new technologies are being developed. If we think about fertility traits in particular, things like days open and calving to first service, these are traits that are clearly impacted more by producers' decision-making than the actual biology of the animal itself. A cow can't help it if a producer doesn't put semen into her when she's in heat. But my job is to breed cows, not farmers. So we have to concentrate on the cows. We know that there is genetic variation behind these traits, and the traits currently being used have been really helpful in making improvements. But I think we can really do better here. We're currently working on developing new traits that are really closer to the biology of the cow. So if you think about things like the size and the position score of the fertility tract or cyclicity of an animal measured by hormone levels, strength of estrus measured with pedometers, these are all things that are much closer to the inside of the cow and help us get a better grasp of how that animal is, how its fertility status is. So if we have traits that are measured on the cows themselves and they can be measured quantitatively, we'll be in a much better position to select superior animals, regardless of management. And of course, the same is really true for health traits. So we need to improve there, but that's the reason why these traits are notoriously difficult to improve.
And another one for you, as you talked, you mentioned several traits that we're looking forward to select and being able to do a more specific selection within the animal level, let's say, not as much as the management level. Do you think we're going to see over the, say, like next years, do you believe we're going to see a big jump in terms of functional traits, and we're going to see big improvements in terms of health and fertility, both because of better management, but also because of quicker and larger gains in terms of genetics on these traits? You believe that that's going to be even faster than it has been?
We're really in an exciting time right now in terms of technological advancement and also in terms of knowledge. Not only in genomics, but also in all the other areas of management like nutrition and housing. public pressure is also forcing us to sort of rethink our practices as well, which is sometimes really uncomfortable, but it can lead to really important improvement. If we use all the available technology together with high quality genotypes and well-suited genetic herd improvement strategies, there is absolutely huge potential for improvement. Of course, if the technology is installed and nobody looks at it, nobody looks at the data coming from that technology, then it's pretty useless. We still need farmers who understand their cows, and no amount of fancy equipment can save a bad farmer. But genotyping and other technologies are indeed tools which can help our industry do better. And I do think that the change might not be really dramatic, but I think that it will be a constant and increasing rate of change in these traits, as we've seen with things like somatic cell score. As soon as we included somatic cell score into the Canadian indexes, all of a sudden we could switch the trend. So I do believe that with a careful selection of functional traits, we can really make healthier cows, for sure.
Chris, we talked a little bit about management, and I think no one better than to speak for about management than you. So do you believe that the management improvements have to come before you genetics select your animals, or do you believe that you have to share the focus between genetics and management to really see improvements?
I really believe both have to happen at the same time. Some of the reasons that when you look back at the dramatic increases in milk production and fat yield that we've had, when you look back to 2012, that's the date we moved into the barn. 2012 was when we moved. We believe before we moved into the barn that we had genetics for milk production, but we didn't have the barn design and the low stress levels to let the animals bring out and fulfill her genetic potential. And what we're about at Larenwood Farms is maximizing the genetic potential that the animal has in her, whether that's to milk at 75 liters or whether that's to milk at 60 is in her genetics. So you need to work on that as well. What we decided when we were going to move into a freestall barn is that we were going to breed for animals that had all the traits for longevity and milk production and health that we needed to have in those facilities. And when we moved into the barn, we got more fat yield, we got more liters because of the low stress nature of the new facility. Not to say you shouldn't be working on genetics at the same time, I believe you should be, but genetics is more of a long-term goal and long-term improvement that you're looking to do. It's not overnight that you suddenly will take a herd milking at average production and make them into 13,000-14,000 liters. It doesn't happen overnight just with genetics. There's some management that plays into that as well. The overall management and health of the herd is your low-hanging fruit that you should work on in the short term with long-term genetic goals in the background.
Very nice to hear the story of all the, and see the results, how you improved. You know, you switch the barns and all of a sudden you were able to see that investment in genetics paying off, right? So another one for you, Chris. How do you manage inbreeding your herd? Do you have a number that you try to stay under in your matings, or you just try to avoid close matings, or how do you deal with that?
Mostly, we don't have a specific number specifically that we look at. We're trying to keep it as low as we can. I try not to breed a similar pedigree of a bull onto similar pedigree of a cow. We've been trying to use more outcross bulls. There's a bull that we've been using a lot from CMEX that is a complete outcross called Speed Up. And that bull himself is going to take our inbreeding levels down quite nicely. So it's not a specific goal of here we needed to hit this percent. It's just avoid using, that being said, I do use alligator in my herd. So that bull has double McCutcheon on the pedigree, and that isn't good for inbreeding. But if there's no McCutcheon in the rest of the pedigree, you can get away with decisions like that. So we're working on it. It's not a specific goal, but it is definitely in the background of something we're interested in.
How for you, Dr. Baes, from the science standpoint, how can inbreeding affect the performance and which tools are available for the producers to be able to manage a little bit better inbreeding?
Yeah, that's a great question that lies really close to my heart, actually. Inbreeding is a bit of a double-edged sword. It has a bad rap because if it's not managed, there can be really, really terrible implications. But on the other hand, selection will increase inbreeding and there's no way around it. So in the genomic era now, we talk about homozygosity, or when an animal receives two copies of the same gene from a common ancestor through both the paternal and the maternal side. when we think about what the implications are of inbreeding, the real implications are caused by these nasty individual alleles. They can spread really quickly through a population. If a really popular AI bull is used, the consequences might only be realized after the damage has been done. One example of this is the cholesterol deficiency haplotype that was identified a few years ago. Animals who had two copies of the gene were born alive, but they died then between 3 weeks and 6 months of age. No matter what treatment they received, they just didn't thrive and eventually they died. So really important sires like Storm and Goldwyn were actually carriers. And I don't need to tell you how popular these bulls were in Canada and around the world. But in any case, a bunch of German farmers started complaining about all of these calf losses, and some research was done, and eventually it became clear what was happening. And what was happening was just that these bulls were spreading a really nasty allele. And when that allele came in homozygous form in an offspring, that animal would die. That's just one example of how homozygosity can negatively affect whole populations. Now, the story isn't always that bad. There are more subtle effects of increased homozygosity, like decreased fitness or lower levels of production, maybe some fertility problems. But there's also really positive examples of homozygosity. There's a gene called diacylglycerase acyltransferase. It's located on chromosome 14. And that gene is actually responsible for 40% of the variation that we see in fat content. And in animals with a positive allele, they have really a clearly higher amount of fat in their milk. So that's why I say it's a double-edged sword. Now, we've done a lot of work trying to understand the implications of homozygosity. It's something that we can't get rid of. But I think Chris's approach is a really good one. Keep it in check, manage it. And with the use of genomic information, we can actually quantify which parts of the genome are particularly nasty and which parts are particularly good. So we really have to adapt our methods and keep it in mind. But I think inbreeding just really is something that we're not going to get away from, and we don't have to. There are mouse lines that have been bred for 65 generations with full sib pairs, and they're still alive and they're still running. But it is indeed a monster that has to be managed a little bit. And I think with these genomic tools, we can do a much better job of managing and controlling that.
Now we're gonna bring up our second poll, or second and last poll. So that's more on genetic selection for A2 and POLD. So have you been selecting or have plans to select for either A2 and or POLD? So that's a multiple choice. So you can pick more than one if you're selecting for one and planning to select for another one. Just gonna leave few more seconds, we get more response. So yeah, it seems that majority is not selecting for either of them, some good amount of people selecting for both, which is interesting. Nice to see that. Yeah, quite a, I would say half of the response not selecting for any of these two traits. So Chris, along with genomics, we're seeing quite a few producers starting selecting for these trend traits, such as H1 polled. So are you selecting or have any plans to select for either of the two?
Definitely, if a bull is just polled and doesn't have all the other characteristics that I'm looking for in production, longevity, and all the other health traits, I'm going to pick the bull that has more of the good things that I'm looking for, more of the health traits, more of the longevity, the stature, the characteristics that will last, keep the animal lasting for a long time. If, for example, a bull has polled genetics and another one doesn't, and they're both equal, I'll pick the polled bull. A2 is something that we're thinking about. We haven't really started selecting for it. I'm still waiting to see if there's a more of a established market, and the logistics of transportation and all that is actually something that will make it a real market that I should select for. But again, there's a lot of other categories. I want to make an animal that lasts a long time, gives a lot of milk, and is trouble-free in mastitis and diseases. And then producing A2 milk and being pulled is something as well as all those other things. It's not the sole reason for selecting a bull.
Dr. Baes, for you now, from the industry perspective, how do you see these traits being incorporated into the selection? Do you believe that with the interest we have from the producers, do you think that in next decades we're going to have 100% of the herd polled and A2?
If I had a crystal ball, I'd make a heck of a lot of money. I think that if that's what farmers want, that's what will happen. But as Chris very clearly mentioned, it won't happen until there are real economic reasons to do so. The technology is there, infrastructure is there to make these changes for known mutations like A2 and polled very rapidly. These genes can be infused into a population using conventional breeding practices, using genomic selection, or even using things that are really spacey, like gene editing, for an even more rapid uptake. The applications of gene editing is no longer a technical one, but it's a regulatory one. So the tools are absolutely there to do this. I don't think that it will happen that quickly, though. And when we look to other traits, it can be a little bit more complicated. We've been working a lot on feed efficiency and methane traits in dairy cattle, and preliminary studies on the socioeconomic aspects of these traits show that when the farmers are interested in increasing feed efficiency, because they see it as affecting their bottom line, but they wouldn't pay more for semen from bulls that produce offspring with lower methane emissions. So it's a really good thing that these two traits are positively correlated. So we can expect that if they increase feed efficiency, we're also going to reduce methane emissions. But ultimately, the inclusion and spread of these genes really has a lot more to do with the economic bottom line than whether or not we can. The tools are there. We can do really a lot, but it has to pay.
So two last quick questions. Those are for both of you. With the increasing awareness of the consumers, I just saw that there's a question about the consumers actually. How do you see these traits, say, for especially I think that polled is a little bit more of a concern of the consumers. How do you see those traits in the future? Do you think that we'll see some good pressure from the consumers? And you mentioned a couple of other traits, Dr. Baes, that we may see more and more pressure to select them. Which other traits you believe are going to be in the spotlight soon?
I guess I'll go. I guess for me, the calf health and the methane emissions are definitely an important traits and definitely things that as a producer that I'd be interested in. Overall, you got to look at the diseases and the conditions that the average consumer can see and relate to. Things like a cow that's down with milk fever or a cow that has a displaced abomasum and things like that. And overall health, I think is really important to continue to select for and continue to have more and more accuracy in so that producers can produce a healthier herd, that people can see milk being produced and can see this done healthy and see that the animals are happy and in a good welfare condition. And that I think is as important as anything. And as we drive forward, it'll the adoption of all of those indexes will rely heavily on how accurate they are and whether a producer sees that when they select for metabolic disease resistance, that they immediately get a return and the animals are healthier and that they have better accuracy. When we move forward, it'd be nice to have accuracy move up from the 73s into the 80s and 90s and in those areas. And I think my one thing I always telling producers, and I know researchers love to hear these sorts of things, is you need to classify and you need to milk test to make the genomic information accurate so that you can then use it with accuracy on the other end. You can't expect to get genomic information and not put in known data to get accurate genomic information. You can't have it both ways. So if we want consumers to and traits that we're interested in, we got to work on the accuracy and work on all the different traits that equal a healthy animal.
Like to add any other trait you believe we're going to be pushing in the future? Oh. Dr. Baes, do you hear
me? Okay. Yeah. I thought you were still talking with Chris.
Sorry.
No, I think, it's a great question. Managing genetics means you have to think in generations. Our cows are pretty fantastic as they are, and changing the makeup of a population shouldn't hinge on fads or on trends. No matter how loud the voices get, the health and the welfare and the efficiency and the production of the cow should take center stage at all times. Now, just thinking about the Buttergate discussions on social media, we could discuss adding things like fatty acid content of milk and milk fat globule size to our breeding goal, because they're also influenced by genetics and they do have a heritability and it would be possible, but I'm not sure it would be wise to change the breeding program until we know exactly what the best nutritional value of milk actually is and if there are better ways of managing those aspects and if those aspects are even real. At the moment, we're taking a really deep look at the current makeup of our selection indices, LPI and ProDollars. There's a lot of traits in there that can be improved, further developed, or some of them could even be removed because they could be replaced with more correct, more biologically relevant traits. But overall, we need to make sure that our breeding goal is balanced. Just because we can change things doesn't necessarily mean that we should. These decisions are really important and they will set the stage not only for our farms here in Canada, but will also affect the genetics of that we give into a huge export market that Canada is very much a part of. So yes, there are always new traits, but we do have to make sure that we maintain a healthy, productive, fertile population of cows here at home. And I think Chris's approach is really relevant. We have to maintain data collection and we have to really strive to do better and constantly be self-critical about what goes into these indices, what weights individual traits get, and whether or not we can improve.
One last quick question for both of you. I'd like to start with Dr. Baes. If you had to give an advice for a producer new to genomics that just started genotyping his females, what would you tell them? How they should use their results?
genomics is an incredible tool that you have at your disposal. The infrastructure is excellent. The logistics work, you can achieve really, really great gains in the traits that you prioritize. If you're unsure of how to do it, do your homework, talk to people, make sure that you have, that you're not just putting money into a black hole, because you really should look at the results and you should think carefully about what your selection decisions are. But if they're new to genomics, then feel free to reach out, and I'm sure that there's many, many people around who can help you on your path, for sure. But a good decision.
For sure. Chris, what about you? What's the advice you would give to a producer new to genomics?
Well, what we did with genomics is a good example at the beginning of what not to do. We selected 4 years ago, selectively tested a few animals, looked at the information. So that's nice. Those animals are high. Yep, those are low. Yep. Okay. Yep. That's good. And did nothing with their information. We didn't select for it. We just took a bill, paid it, and thought, why are we paying this bill, and stopped doing it. And then 3 years ago, we said, we need to take a philosophy of testing every animal. You have to test all the animals and look for, because there's surprises. There's ones that you think should be low, that the genetics come back and are very, very high. They're high in type, they're high in their characteristics for production, for indexes, and you keep those animals and you see the results later on and you're like, wow, I really should have, a good thing I kept that animal. And you have to treat it as a tool in conjunction with other things. As I said earlier, you have to treat it for me, it's pedigree, it's the pedigree of the animal, it's the genomics of her, and it's the animal standing in front of me. If the first two pedigree and genomics show you that the animal is going to be great and you look at her and she is a short, dumpy little cow that doesn't look like she'll milk, probably maybe she had some disease in her life and probably isn't going to fulfill her potential. And maybe you need to cull them. And I really think you need to focus on, focus on the best ones and try and perpetuate your genetics through those great animals and try not to waste too much time on the ones that aren't going to improve the herd. And if you look at our herd over the last 3 years, our slope for genetic improvement is well above average because we've made those decisions in that way. I think you gotta decide to make decisions with the information, not just pay a bill.
Dad. So I'd like to thank Dr. Baes and Chris McLaren for this great talk. Just a note before we open the floor for questions, this was the first of a series of webinars we're planning to run in 2021. The next one we are aiming to have around May. Probably going to talk about classification and confirmation assessment as a management tool. I really focus on the management side of things. So anyone that would like to make a question on the mic, would like to ask to raise our hand. To do that, you can click on reaction on the bottom of your video. There's a smiley face and you click on reaction and click raise our hand. So then we're gonna give you the floor to ask the question. Also, feel free to ask any questions in the chat box as well. We have some questions there already. And also we're going to keep the session open for a few more minutes as we're done. So anyone can leave a question there, and we're going to make sure we can address everything. And we have one raised hand. So like Stefan, I'm not sure if I'm saying correct your name. Please have the floor and ask the first question.
Guys, yeah. Hello?
Yeah, we hear you.
Okay. Hey, great presentation, by the way. I do have a question for Christine. I do genomically test the calves, and I struggle with picking out these calves. You know, like I use a combination of proven bulls and genomic bulls, and you know, when they're born, the genomic calves from the genomic sires are always a lot higher, but the reliability on the proven bulls are better, you know, like choosing between those two, like how do I decide what to go with?
It's like playing Russian roulette, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's where that bullet is, right? And that's a bit of a problem. No. So yeah, the reliability is of course really important. I mean, we can get into the statistical definition of what a reliability is. It's basically the correlation between the true and the estimated breeding value. And proven bulls will always give you a higher reliability than genomic bulls, almost always, unless they've got millions of offspring. So it's kind of, it's a little bit how willing you are to take a risk. But one thing is pretty clear through genomics is that the younger bulls, if they've got a really high genomic value, they've got a pretty good reliability, using them is probably going to get you ahead, just because of the fact that that genetic progress has been made on the bull side. Between 85 and 90% of genetic progress is made on the sire side, just because of the selection intensity that's used in choosing those bulls. You're limiting a bunch of other things, so there's a whole bunch of trade-offs there, but younger bulls tend to be, in general, more probable of having a higher production and higher traits, not just production across the board, than the older bulls. It's just, I won't say it's totally blind faith, but it is a little bit of blind faith, because without that reliability, you don't have the absolute guarantee that that animal is going to do well. But your bets are pretty well supported by what's around. But
thanks a lot, and that's a great answer. I also I guess in a way struggle because I'm a smaller operator, and so my the variety of young sires, or I mean genomic bulls that I choose from, are limited. And so I don't have, I guess, the economies of scale to be able to say that, you know, these bulls, how much faith can I put on an individual genomic bull? You know what I mean? Like, do you understand what I'm trying to ask? Like, how much faith can I put into these numbers in that sense?
Chris is smiling already.
Do you mind if I? I think for me, like when I'm selecting genomic bulls, I had to write down the bulls that I'm using genomically, because I don't use heavily any one bull. I will use, we milk 100 cows, so I'll use 10 or 15 doses on one bull. I'll move on to another bull. I'll move on to another bull. I'll move on to another bull and spread my risk out. And I also try, when I make a breeding decision on a young genomic bull with high type, or a proven bull with different, say higher type or production. If your criteria for selecting, before you start genomics, you need to decide what your criteria is. If you're picking based on index and you're going to use a bull, I use mostly CMEX. So if you use a bull, say like Sidekick, and you are surprised when you find the bull at the end, when you get your result, that bull is low, you need to make the decision when you make that breeding decision and use Sidekick that you're going to keep that calf, right? You are going to keep that calf regardless, because your decision was to select and cull based on LPI and pro dollar, but you've just set up that calf at subsequent breeding to be low in pro dollar and LPI because you selected Sidekick. You can't select the bulls with low numbers and then cull based on numbers because the bull didn't have a chance to keep that. So I think with genomics, you got to spread out the bulls so that you don't have that, that economy of scale that you can't get. You need to make sure you spread out your risk and make conscious decisions when you breed an animal that what you're doing. Does that make sense? I don't know if that answers any questions, but I just wanted to get that point out.
Yeah, no, I would agree with that. I think that's a very good answer as well.
Ben is going to bring a couple of questions from the chat for us before we give the floor for Brian and Phyla. Ben?
Hello? This is new to me.
So Jerome had a question in the chat. You mentioned genotyping results are 70% accurate, but how reliable are the estimates for milk production and components if the mother is no longer registered for milk production with Valacta and has never been genotyped? Christine, do you want to tackle that one?
I can try. it's difficult because without the registration. It's really difficult because you sort of not cut off your legs, but you, I know that this is a hot topic, and I think there are a few questions in the chat that go this way as well. The classification system is the way in Canada that people record conformation traits. DHI and Valacta and CanWest, that's sort of the milk recording data collection part. And then there are also producer recorded traits, things like, you know, health traits, clinical ketosis, metabolic diseases, et cetera. Those are actually collected by the producers. And all of that data together flows into LactaNet, formerly CDN. It's really hard to say what the reliability is for animals that are not involved in that system, just because we don't know. You need to have, if there are, you know, I could tell you if you had 50 half sibs, if you had information on 400 daughters from the bull.
I think so.
Am I still here?
Yeah, you're still here, Chris.
Okay. I'm having internet issues, so that's why I ask.
I think we lost Dr. Baes.
Appears that way. Well, I can answer a question.
Go ahead.
Someone was asking, what is the best age to genomically test, and does it make a difference when you do it? Genomically test, we test everything once a month. Everything that's been born in the last month, we test them, and then we get results every 6 to 8 weeks after that. So usually by about 8 or 10 weeks of age, the animal has genomic results.
Another quick one for you, Chris.
What's our average herd life?
We have about a third plus lactation is about 40 to 45%, somewhere in there. So I don't know, whatever that works out at average.
That's fair. So
Brian, yeah, that's what our numbers are.
Brian, do you want to ask the question?
All right. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay. I've been genomic testing for, let's say, last 4 years or longer. And I've been flushing my best cows in the herd and getting embryos and then testing the daughters and seeing my results. I missed the DVG quite a bit. I found the DVD showed a lot of information of what that animal directly did. For me to pick out bulls, genomic bulls, because I'm 100% genomic and I want to use the newest and the latest genomic bulls within 15 to 20 months. What I have learned over the number of years is that you need, when picking a genomic bull, you have to predict what will she be a proven bull in about 6 years. And I base that on mostly looking at rear udder, fore udder. When the classifier comes into your herd, it's pretty much what are the important traits to make a solid proven bull. So that's how I base my genomics on, I guess, is finding that bull that I feel comfortable that will make a long lasting cow, not today, but a cow that will be around for
5 years and hopefully classify in the top 20, let's go top 25 to 50 LPI list. Yeah, that's just my thoughts on genomics. I really like it. And yeah, I guess it's not really a question. It's more of a my feeling about genomics, I guess. That's all.
Brian, that's good. Good to hear that. I think that adds up very well to what Chris is doing and you know, reaching good results. Thank you so much. Rafaela, do you have a question? Have the floor, please.
Hi, I'm Rafaela Rinocchiero. I work at the Italian Holstein Association. So I'm more used to the, we are used to the Italian system. And I had one question from Chris, but I think it was already in the chat. The question is, was at which age do you genotype? And if you genotype the entire newborns, or you just choose what? I don't remember if you had said this already at the beginning of your presentation. And the other question was for Christine, but I think we lost her. And it was
how lost Christine.
I think back. And the question is, how difficult is to convince farmers to genotype?
Rafaela, I think you know the answer to that.
Yeah, but I wanted if we can discuss that.
Yeah.
I had one thing. The genotyping is in Canada, how it is? It is offered by the system, or the farmers choose to genotype their own animals?
So that's a lot of questions. I think I can answer the first one. I can say in a nutshell, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink. The tools that we have today for genotyping are excellent. We have, the infrastructure is there. Everything is there. But the beauty and also the monster behind this beautiful opportunity is that everybody can still make their own decisions. We are not in a position to force anyone to do anything that they don't want to do. What we can do is calmly and comprehensively look at what genomics can offer. We can put it on we can offer it. And if producers want to use it, some will embrace it and some will want to burn it at the stake. Basically, there's nothing that we can do about that. We can only concentrate on doing the best we can. And it's the same with everything. There are fast followers, there are industry leaders, and there are members of the industry that really don't want to follow. And that's okay. We might need them at some point. But if you want to make genetic gains, genomic testing looks like it's the way to go in today's world. With regards to the genotyping, Murillo, maybe someone from, maybe either you or Holstein Canada can better explain that than I can.
Yeah, here in Canada, each producer decides the animals that they would like to genotype. So it's the producer decision. Of course, from a breed standpoint, we would like more and more animals being genotyped, so we promote that. But it is really, by the end of the day, is the producer's decision. Just in a few cases, say if you have a male, it must be genotyped. If you have if you're flushing a cow or collecting oocytes, she must be genotyped as well. But other than that, it's completely breeder's decision. Chris, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I select all the animals that I want to genotype. Yeah. And what was the first part? I don't know what else to say that hasn't already been said by Christine. So
awesome. Sounds good. One quick one for you, Chris. When you started genomic testing, did you test all the herd or just the young animals?
When we first started, as I said, when I first started 4 or 5 years ago, we tested a few animals here or there, but now we test everything. It's important to test everything so you have some idea where the good ones are and where the the opportunities are maybe to call an animal and take some, and we're using it as a way to raise less animals as well, right? We're creating more beef crosses, as well as any of the ones that don't look like they have the potential are being sold off as young an age as we can. We'd prefer to sell them at 8 to 10 weeks of age. The market right now for those aged animals isn't really there. So we sell them mostly at open heifers, 8 to 10 months of age, to people. So.
Sounds good. So we're advancing in time. So I'd like to thanks everybody. So whatever, whoever have any other questions, please leave in the chat box. We're gonna leave the meeting open for another few minutes. And we're gonna work with Dr. Baes and Chris to have an answer. We're gonna get back to you via email, or if you need any feedback from that we can help, feel free to contact us, contact Holstein Canada, that we can reach out and we answer a question and we solve your problem. That's
well, the way. And for me personally, like, if somebody wants to know more about genomics and what we're doing on the farm, and they can contact you and they can get my information on email, text, whatever. And I'm more than happy to answer any questions or talk to them about anything that they can text me and tell me what a horrible way it is that I genomically test all these animals and provide me all kinds of angry emojis and all kinds of things. If they really want to, I'll accept it. But so it's entirely up to them how they contact.
Sounds good. Thanks a lot, Chris. Christine would like to say anything to close
same.
Up?
Same for me. If you guys have any questions, please don't be afraid to reach out. I'm sure Murillo can pass on my contact information. And I love discussing with farmers and hearing what's going on.
Is it possible for you to put your contact information in the chat for people to make notes on?
Sure.
Well, as we close, I'd like to thanks again, Christine, Dr. Christine Baes and Chris McLaren. It's great conversation. I personally really enjoyed getting a little bit of all your experience and expertise. And thanks a lot, everyone that signed up and took a little bit of our afternoon to be with us here today. Really appreciate it. And we hope to see you again in the next seminar webinars that we are planning to have. Thanks a lot and have a great afternoon, everyone. Have a good day.